Does your financial advisor take the time to really listen to you? Is your financial strategy personalized to you and your family? Will your financial advisor be there as your life and financial situation change? Hi, I'm Jerry Mangona, your Edward Jones financial advisor. I live here in Corktown, just a few blocks from the Daily Detroit studios. And when we work together, we'll focus on what's important to you. We'll use an established process to create a personalized financial strategy backed by the advice, tools, and resources to help you reach your goals. And we'll partner together to help your strategy stay on track. Contact me toll-free today at 866-975-8655. Again, that's 866-975-8655. Edward Jones, member SIPC.
Hello, friends, and welcome to your Daily Detroit. It is Thursday, April 27th, 2023. We are sharing what to know and where to go around Southeast Michigan. Jam-packed show today. Joining me, Shianne Serini. How are you?
I'm great, Jer. How are you?
Good, good. You know, we've been on some adventures and all kinds of things that we're going to tell people about. But Shianne, before we got here, you sent me a message before we got in the studio. And you were like, I have a secret to tell you. And I want to know what that, like, you want to share it with listeners and everyone. And I'm trying to figure out, like, I am stressed about this secret. I'm, like, wondering, like, are you going to quit? Like, what is happening here?
I'm not quitting, thank guys. God. I'm not quitting. So I have a secret. I guess I would say it's more of a guilty pleasure. And he's coming to town, Jer. I have a secret. I love Barry Manilow.
You got me good. So you love the Copacabana, huh?
I do. I love Copacabana.
So that listeners know, I heard earlier this week, because we get the press releases and whatever, I think Barry Manilow's coming to town right in August. I think the end of August-ish.
August 22nd.
Okay, Little Caesars Arena,
yes.
Right? Okay.
Yes.
All right, so tell me about Barry Manilow and why you love Barry Manilow so much and why you're excited he's coming to Little Caesars Arena.
Okay, first of all, I have seen Barry Manilow in person.
But you wouldn't turn down a ticket.
I would not turn down a ticket. I have seen him in Las Vegas.
Oh.
The show was fun. It was a good time. A lot of old women around me singing along with him, which I guess maybe I am also a 65-year-old woman trapped in a 40-year-old woman's body. I don't know what it is. I've always loved Barry Manilow. Even as a little girl, my mom used to listen every Saturday night. The radio station would have disco night, and it would always open with Copacabana, and I would always listen to it. Like, I would tape it. I would get my boombox out, and I would...
As if people can see, it's the two fingers, so you can hit the record and play button.
Yes.
Our younger listeners will have no idea what we're talking about. There was something so satisfying about the clunk.
Yes.
The clunk, and then you'd make the mixtape off the radio, and so you'd have to listen to the radio and be ready at the end of each song. Is this the song that you want to add to the mixtape for whoever you're going to give it to or save?
Yeah, yeah. So I've always loved him. And also, little fact, he used to be the pianist for Bette Midler.
I feel like you like Bette Midler too.
I do love Bette Midler, yes. I've also seen Bette Midler in Las Vegas at Caesar's Palace.
That's amazing.
Anyway.
Well, you know, a lot of our listeners, we get this interesting report every month from at least our Spotify listeners. I don't know a lot about individuals, but I know bigger trends. And one of them is that you all love Taylor Swift.
Mm-hmm.
I have not seen Barry Manilow in this lineup. So what I want to know, dailydetroit@gmail.com, what is your guilty music pleasure with Barry Manilow coming into town? There's going to be a lot more. You know, we're coming up on concert season. What is the guilty music pleasure? What is it that you love that you don't necessarily tell people that you love it? I want to hear all of it. I want, when we come back with you next week, I want to discuss all of these guilty pleasures.
I am eager to find out all of your guilty pleasures because I just told a major one. Don't be afraid. We won't name names. I promise. This can be completely anonymous.
All right, let's talk development news a little bit. We were at a new thing called NewLab this week. It is the reimagining of the old Book Depository building built in the 30s next to Michigan Central Station. It was bought by Ford, now managed by this Brooklyn-based It's like kind of co-working on steroids. I want to talk about this a little bit because the initial description to the media of like what this is, then I talked to some people and like got an actual idea of what this really is. Cause like there's a lot of words, since there's a lot of like venture investment yeah. and platforms and transformation. Let me just bring it out this way. I'm glad, one, that this space is being reused. I also think that this is a pretty big bet on by Ford because it's not completely filled up yet. It's something where they're going to be needing to fill it up. It's going to be for these mobility companies. Now, let's talk about the words that are involved in this to me. I know that a lot of people don't think about co-working as much anymore because of WeWork's rise. And, you know, it's still around, like, without a doubt. Yeah. WeWork's still a big deal, but it's not as culturally in the story, especially after their very flashy ex-CEO founder left the stage. They're more of a company that just does things. But a lot of people think, oh, co-working isn't a thing. I will argue that co-working is still very much a thing for a lot of companies, maybe mm-hmm. some of the smaller ones. This is co-working, but it's a different kind of co-working. This is for early stage companies, and there's prototyping. Think of it as like co-working and machine shop, prototype shop, showroom. This is for these next generation inventions and ideas for getting around. The idea that whether it supports the car, kind of an idea of for cities and places where it's not about the car. Like we saw some four-wheeled things there.
Yeah.
There were some interesting things. There was pieces of factory equipment, and not for display, but for use mm-hmm. from Ford factories brought in so that these companies can make this stuff. I thought it was really interesting. I know that you had some interesting things that you saw, the one that you wanted to mention.
Yeah, I was just walking around. I was actually looking for you because we kind of got lost. Because
it's huge.
It was huge. And also, it was packed with people. It was a who's who's of an event, I just got to say.
I felt like I was somebody. Like, there's all these fancy people.
I did too, but
I'm like, how did they invite us?
Well, we're media, so of course. But one of the things I saw was like a tire changing machine. And I just sat there and watched this machine just like taking tires off and then putting tires back on. And I was just like kind of transfixed by it because normally I'm so used to like just seeing like people with tools taking off tires and putting them back on.
That's interesting. I think about this with the EV transformation because GM just trimmed one of their key models, the most affordable model, the Bolt. Yeah. I believe it's going to be replaced by a version of the Blazer. Anyway, the change in EVs, yeah, we can talk environment. But I think in a lot of ways that change is also about supply chains and making things more interchangeable, making it a car more like a phone. The idea that if all the parts are easily swappable, you could have a robot do yeah. something like this in the future. I guess the idea would be is to free up technicians to do more in-depth stuff. Again, this isn't technology that's out and ready yet or any of this stuff, but I think that's a portend of the future, mm-hmm. you know, because in a lot of ways, EVs will kind of crush supply chains. You need so fewer parts
yeah.
than for a combustion engine. And then if you set it up in a way that it is kind of hot swappable, it is something where you could have, in many cases, a automated process to do this. And people don't realize, like, Metro Detroit is a huge center for robotics. Like, people might make fun of it, but there is a reason why Automation Alley is in Oakland County, because there's a huge amount of robotic stuff. It's stuff that the media usually does not cover.
Well, because it's not flashy.
Yeah, you're right. You're absolutely right.
It's dorky and geeky. But you know what? Those robotics teams in high school and stuff and onward, they create really innovative tools for all of us to use.
Well, remember when I interviewed tech journalist Kara Swisher mm-hmm. just before the pandemic? That was like a thing.
Yeah.
And talking about how the car is the most complex consumer product. Like, making cars is no joke. It's how can we apply some of those skills and then branch them off to other things. Now, with this being a mobility space, this is about those kinds of technologies. What did you think about the design of the place? You know, the Book Depository is a very open space in a lot of ways. It was welcoming, but it was cavernous.
I thought they did a very good job in renovating a space that had been empty for many years. And I'm glad that it is still around because it is an Albert Kahn building. I did get lost a couple times. There's a lot of twists and turns. But I think that they did a very good job. And I love that open skylight in the middle. It just brings in so much light.
Well, and there's going to be showroom spaces for showing off these things. There's going to be a lot of investment activity happening around this. The idea being that this is kind of the future of things. One thing that I noticed was completely, I know this is completely a weird thing, and I tweeted about it, but I had to share it. The bathrooms, the faucets have temperature gauges.
I know.
And
I saw
then they have timers. And I don't know if you know this. I messed with some of the timers. I gave myself an extra minute of water. I was like, what is this?
I saw that too. I saw the temperature and I was like, oh, this is really cool. I really like this.
One thing I'll note too, though, is the kind of the design of everything. It's really turning into a campus over there.
It is.
It's not like a dense situation of like building on building. I realized when I walked out of the book depository, because it was so far away to the garage that we needed a shuttle.
Yeah.
But this is a campus layout.
Now, we did use a shuttle, but that was because it kind of was rainy and gross.
Yeah, but it was quite a distance.
It was a distance, but there is a walkway from the garage to the campus, and it'll be lit and it's nice. And I was kind of bummed that it was raining because I would have walked it, but I was like, I'm not walking that far in the rain.
But the density of this is definitely much more of a campus feel. Like if you've gone to a corporate campus, that is kind of the energy for him. And, you know, it's funny to me because I think you remember years ago, publications ago, remember when I made the call of like the way that Michigan Central is going to get renovated is as a corporate campus because that's the only thing that really makes sense.
Yeah.
I mean, there will be a hotel bit and there will be some other things, but the heart of this is a corporate campus.
Yeah. I do like the fact that when you walk right out, Michigan Central is right there.
Oh, it's beautiful.
And it's wonderful. And I was just like, look at
and
it.
They're doing, redoing, making park improvements.
Yes.
They're rerouting some of that traffic. So make sure the next time you go through there, all this is coming together really fast.
It is. I was telling my mom that I was going to NewLab and the opening, and she was like, how is that already? It's already almost done. And I was like, yeah, the train station's like almost finished and we'll be able to go and check that out later.
It definitely lapped District Detroit.
It did.
And we'll have a little bit of news on that, too, at the tail end of the show. Now, you went somewhere I didn't, because although we did not air for a few days, the wheels of podcasting and newslettering do not stop here at Daily Detroit.
They do not.
And you took one for the team. Really? No, this was an enjoyable one. I was actually kind of jealous about this one because you were talking about Nick Nerds, and I am.
Yeah.
Said. Anyone who listens to the show knows that I'm a giant nerd.
I am, too.
Right. Like, we're talking about our own here. I would totally have a temperature-controlled faucet.
I would, too. I was bummed that I missed going to the Hurlbut Monument.
The gate, yeah.
The gate with the new eagle. I was bummed that I had to miss that. But then you said, hey, they're putting together a tour for us to check out the Waterworks Park plant. And I said, oh, I will make time for that. And then I got an email from you saying, I can't go.
And you were like, oh, darn.
And I said, oh, well, I'll go. So I got
again,
to go.
Again, taking one for the team.
I got to go to the Waterworks plant tour, and you got to go to the gate. So I think we're square.
I'll take it.
But yeah, I got to go on Monday to the plant to do a tour. I don't know what I was expecting.
So this is at Waterworks Park on East Jefferson.
Yes.
There's the intake there right over by Belle Isle. You can see it if you go to like Hipster Beach or whatever and look out there. You can see like it almost looks like a weird little building in the middle of the river.
Yeah. So that's the intake. And there is also another intake up in Port Huron. So
Port Huron would be a great bar. I'd like to go to Port Huron. Does that exist? I need to Google really quick if there's such a thing as Port Huron. And if there isn't, somebody needs to start it.
All they serve is bacon product.
No, I'm searching it. No, nobody. I don't see free business free advice business right there. Just like I want to start another place called Hamtramck. I don't know. Polish sausages, that's all that stuff, Hamtramck.
I don't know exactly what I was anticipating going to the plant tour, but it was legitimately a plant tour. They showed us all of the processes of how the water comes in. Well, we didn't see the intake, but they told us how the water comes in and then all of the different processes that it goes through. And there were like 13 different stops in this tour, Jer.
One more than the Stations of the Cross.
And actually, it was really cool because the Great Lakes Water Authority's CEO, Cheryl Porter, took us on the tour herself and showed us everything. So the Great Lakes Water Authority serves 3.8 million people in the state. in 112 communities. So that's really big. And there's,
well, that's one of the reasons why they get so many arrows, yeah, frankly, because that's a huge area to serve.
Yeah.
And something's going to go wrong sometimes.
Yes, there is. But the one thing that she said was, you know, beforehand, the water treatment plants kind of were like, didn't really talk much to the public. And they're trying to be more forthcoming with like how things work and how things are going. And they're working on being transparent. So this is kind of why they're doing the tours and everything. And also with the plant that was opened in 2003 at Waterworks Park, it's actually set up for tours because before, different processes were in different buildings. And so it was not tour friendly. That is a big swath of land.
Also possibly not very efficient.
Not efficient. And also like probably not safe.
Right. Well, that's one thing we haven't really gotten into is, you know, a lot of things were not maintained because there wasn't the budget.
No.
Like we can talk about who leases what and all that other stuff. But the reality was is there hasn't been enough money to do a lot of things for a long time.
Yeah. And it's a 24-hour plant and it takes a lot of hands on deck to make sure that the water is coming in, it's being processed correctly, it's being safe, and it's good for us to drink. It just was a really cool process. I think my favorite part of the process, Jer, it was the grossest part, probably. It's called flocculation. And
is there a literal poop shoot?
Not really, but...
Oh, I guess that would be the other plant.
That's the other plant. That's sewage. But flocculation is when they bring in the water, they do the pretreatment, which has chemicals.
Do the flocculator.
That has the chemicals in it that start pulling the solid parts that's in the water. So like dirt and bacteria and all the gross stuff. It kind of like attracts those pieces together and then they start clumping together. So it's like this slow turning fan on the bottom that kind of like swirls the water. And then there's three different tubs and each tub goes slower and slower and slower. So it makes like clumps of solid mass. And then it gets put into the sediment tank. And then that gets like separated from the clean water from the solids. And then
that's interesting. So using physical processes to do some of this stuff.
Yes, with chemicals. So right. With the solid mass, it gets put into a centrifuge and spun, like it's a spin cycle on a really big washer. And then once it dries out, it turns into mud patties and it gets put onto a conveyor belt and put into the back of a truck and shipped to a landfill. So that's how our water system works, guys.
Wow, that's the beginning of an interesting... I think we might dive into more of this.
Yeah, it was really interesting. It was about a 45-ish minute tour. The other cool part was that inside the plant, there's a mini plant. And it's like...
I feel like there's a Dr. Evil reference in here somewhere, right? Like the mini plant and the mini me.
So it's a working plant model within the plant. So they can do research. They can... do more testing. They can have grad students come in and do their own work in the mini plant. So yeah, it was really cool that we got to check that out.
I'll be thinking of that the next time I drink some water. It's interesting to see the history of that place. Now, you didn't get to go into the pump house though, because that when you drive down Jefferson and see that historic pump house, which I understand is still working, like that's
it is.
It's been upgraded over time, but and I've seen various pictures of it, but I've always wanted to go inside. Did you get the pump house?
I did not get to go into the pump house.
Oh.
But it's been in continuous use since 1914.
Wow.
Since it opened. Continuous use. And I was really bummed that I didn't get to go to the pump house as well, because I wish I could have just driven by.
Like stand on a stool and like peer in a window or something?
Yeah, but I probably didn't want to get in trouble. One of the things I felt like was I don't belong here. Even though I was invited to go. But I was very much like on my P's and Q's and did not like try and go anywhere besides the main plant. They did say that if we wanted to, we could have drove over to the Hurlbut Gate monument, but I didn't want to press my luck. So I didn't get to go to the pump house.
So I feel like we need to collect them all. We'll just keep hounding them.
Can we just go to the pump house?
We just want
to
stare at it for a while. Yeah,
I just
bring some lawn chairs.
Yeah, I just want to look at it.
And to repeat, like this is all in an area that was Waterworks Park. You know, you can look at old postcards, pictures online. I think historicdetroit.org has some stuff on it. It was a magical public place. However, right after World War II, and during World War II, but right after World War II, they made it permanent. where it's basically a very high security perimeter.
Yes.
I know that some people are like, who would go after the water? Well, guess what? Like, a lot of people would go after the water. Like, that's a top terrorism target. So that's why it's not open to the public. That's why they're trying to do things that are more accessible, but they need to be very careful about it because that is still a real thing.
Yeah. Now, they do tours. You can, if you're part of an organization or you have a school group that might want to go and do a tour, you can, like, request a tour. It does take some time to get it put together, and there's some requirements that you need to meet.
Well, it's just very different to allow, say, 20 or 30 people on
exactly
versus open season whenever you want all over the park.
Exactly. So I thought it was very cool, geeked to be there, and I was like, okay, this is a cool process.
One last thing before we go. I want to mention this with you because you're a bit familiar with it because they have a location near your neck of the woods. The Sahara Restaurant and Grill is coming to Detroit in the District Detroit. This will be their fourth spot with indoor-outdoor seating, a bakery, catering, all that stuff. Bring some Mediterranean down to what they're calling now the Columbia Street neighborhood as part of the District Detroit. I will put a pin in this and say I remember talking about this in 2018, 2019 when this was supposed to happen.
Yep.
So it's been a minute. This is a long-paused development, right? It's not new, but it's long pause. It is interesting to see that Columbia Street, whether it's the Union Joint that is there, or the other things that there's like the milkshake place, JoJo's. Yeah. There are things really popping up. They're finally starting to go in that Columbia Street neighborhood. But I've not been to Sahara and you have. So I know it's been a minute, but like fill me in.
I've been there once or twice. It's been a while since I've been back, but we do have one close by our house. And Middle Eastern food, pretty solid. I do really enjoy Middle Eastern food and Mediterranean food. So I'm excited that they're moving downtown.
There's actually getting to be some good Mediterranean options across downtown. I think there's that spot that's right there by the hospital that's pretty solid.
Yeah. And then there's also Anita's Kitchen down in Financial District.
There's a few different things.
Yeah.
So it's a good thing. Like there's going to be more options, you know. I want to see more stuff in that District Detroit area that are not just for game day. So that's what I'm really pulling for.
Yeah.
Because I think there's just so much unmet potential there. I know that it's hard, right? What's the chicken? What's the egg with people coming down? There isn't enough population around it to support it.
No.
Like with the residents, there's just not enough population density. But then also, how do you incentivize? Right. You got to have population density, or you got to also incentivize people to come down and be like, okay, I'm going to go check out these things on a non-game day.
Yeah.
I would love to see more of that and more of a 24/7 neighborhood there. But we'll see. I'm glad to see a new opening. And I know that it's something that a lot of our listeners will see and, you know, be interested in stopping in. So, yeah, you know, solid Mediterranean choice. All right. We are done for today. Obviously, there is so much more to talk about. Devin O'Reilly joins me for our Friday show. A lot to unpack, some extra development stuff, some business stuff, all the things that we do with Devin, because we've kind of run out of time here with our usual time slot with you, Cheyenne.
Yeah.
It is. I know you got to get out. It's not that we have to stop the podcast for podcast reasons, but you got to get out the door and take care of a couple of things. But
I do.
It's so good for you to stop by the North End.
I am so happy to be here and that I was able to sneak away from my house and away from my family.
And now you're going to sneak back.
And now I have to sneak back, unfortunately. But it was great to be here.
With that, I am Jer Stays. Thank you so much to our members on Patreon, patreon.com/DailyDetroit. Y'all have really stepped up, and it's a big deal. Thank you so very much. As always, feedback, dailydetroit@gmail.com. With that, I'm Jer Stays.
And I'm Cheyenne Ozzarini.
Remember that you are somebody, and we'll see you around Detroit.